Well, I want to welcome you this evening to AU's annual recognition of Constitution Day. We do have a fairly distinguished panel here to discuss the topic, President's power to commit America to combat, constitutional, moral, and practical considerations. So in order of their appearance, we have Dr. Ostrower, a professor of history, Dr. Chris Churchill, assistant professor of history, Dr. Emrys Westacott, professor of philosophy, and Joseph Sempolinski. I invited Joe because he's a graduate student completing his dissertation at Yale University, and his dissertation advisor is David Mayhew, who's one of the premier scholars and political parties in this country, and he served as a teaching assistant to Akhil Amar in his constitutional law class, and Amar is clearly one of the top constitutional scholars in the country. I mean, his work is very good. So I thought Joe might have a few things to say. He's also works with Congressman Reed's office, and so he's got a pretty good insight as to how Congress views some of these issues. And last but not least is Jeff Sluyter-Beltrao, associate professor of political science. So each of these will be making brief remarks in that order. And the important thing is, with five people, it is important to keep it fairly brief. And then we'll allow them to comment on each other's thoughts there if something really is salient in their minds. And then, of course, we'll turn it over to the audience and let you folks ask some questions and try to make this a pretty wide flowing discussion. So Dr. Ostrower, take it away.
Thanks. Thanks for inviting us.
Put the mic a little closer.
Sure. Is this better? Can you hear me? Okay. One thing I want to just mention, Bob mentioned the Constitution Day. You all ought to have, assuming you have smartphones, put a Constitution app on your smartphone. There are many of them around. They are free. And I think every American ought to carry one with him or with her. I don't have a lot of time, so I'll try to make a few points, if I may, about the subject of presidential power as it pertains to war making and the use of force. I suppose the most basic is simply this, that in Article 1 of Section 8 of the Constitution, the president is given the power. I'm sorry, not the president, but the Congress is given the power to declare war. That was very, very specific in the sense that the founders, the men who authored that Constitution, clearly did not want to give that power to the president. There's a reason, and the reason is that they feared that a president might go to war to enhance his own prestige, to enhance his reputation. They believed that Congress would be less likely to fall into that kind of a trap, so they provided that power to Congress. But in Article Number 2, the article does, which focuses on presidential power, gives the president the right to serve as the commander-in-chief of the both Army and separately of the Navy. Now, over the last 224 years, in other words, since 1789, there have only been five declarations of war. You probably know what they are from your high school history courses. In 1812, Congress declared war against the British. In 1846, it did so against Mexico. I might say that since the president at that time, Pope, asked Congress to do so, he had that declaration of war, the wording of that declaration of war, authored before the war actually began. Might tell you something about his own aggressive designs for land. Against Spain in 1898, in World War I in 1917, and again, of course, in World War II after Pearl Harbor, when the United States declared war separately on Japan, and then a few days later against Germany. And there were many, many declarations of war back in that period. There has not been a single declaration of war by the United States government since 1945, and there have been very, very few by other countries since 1945. And that has a lot to do with the nature of the United Nations Charter, and I really don't have time to get into all that. But we've fought about 200 military engagements since 1789. And about 195 of those, or more perhaps even, were without war declarations. Most of these, but not all of these, occurred with authorization from Congress. In other words, the President may ask Congress to authorize the war, even though it's not going to be technically a declared war. And we start there with the quasi-war with France in 1797. It's sometimes called the Naval War with France. And it includes recent wars. It includes the war in Afghanistan that we're involved in right now, the recent war with Iraq. And I want to offer a word about whether such authorization is necessary. Most presidents, regardless of their political party, have, in fact, certainly in the 20th century, have wanted to expand presidential authority, which means that they have argued that military action is often legal without authorization. When? Most commonly, number one, with talking about the engagements without authorization from Congress, when the war, or if you will, the engagement, is a very short duration, when the action involves a very limited use of force. So, for instance, in 1985, President Reagan, I guess it was really 1986, did not ask Congress for authorization when American fighter jets attacked Colonel Gaddafi's Libya, twice actually attacked Libya, the first in retaliation having to do with some Libyan threats to American planes, having to do with an issue having to do with the freedom of the seas, and then secondly, when the Libyans sponsored a terror attack on an American discotheque in Berlin, killing a number of American soldiers. Nor, for instance, did President Clinton, okay, Reagan, of course, is a Republican, Clinton a Democrat, nor did Clinton ask for authorization when in 1998 he struck what he believed was an al-Qaeda factory in the Sudan in a one-time strike. But longer campaigns, such as that in Afghanistan or such as that in Iraq, have almost always included congressional authorization, including, I might add, the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution in 1964, which formalized U.S. engagement in the Vietnam War. Now, I'm going to come back to that in a moment. But what about the War Powers Resolution, which is often called the War Powers Act? Not quite correctly, it's really War Powers Resolution. It was approved as a joint resolution by Congress in 1973, the year that we left Vietnam. And it was a response to what many in Congress, of both parties, believed to be the misuse of American power, of military power, by a series of presidents. For while President Johnson had gotten Congress to authorize the Tonkin Gulf Resolution way back in 1964, President Kennedy, even before 1964, without any authorization from Congress, had used American force in Vietnam for a number of years. And Nixon continued to employ force in Vietnam even after 1970, when Congress, by an overwhelming majority, repealed the Tonkin Gulf Resolution. In other words, the Tonkin Gulf Resolution was repealed by a vote of 82-10. Many Republicans and many Democrats joining together to essentially deauthorize the use of force in Vietnam. Now, the War Powers Resolution has three key provisions. First of all, if force is used, Congress must be notified within 48 hours. Number two, and force cannot be used for longer than 60 days without congressional authorization. Okay, and then it actually has a little bit of a little smudge factor there, an additional 30 days under certain conditions, particularly if you want to withdraw those forces. And thirdly, that the resolution also authorizes Congress by concurrent resolution to end hostilities in the event that there is no declaration of war or a congressional authorization if American forces are fighting outside of the boundaries of the United States itself or our possessions. And here's the rub. For every president since 1973, even Jimmy Carter, has questioned the constitutionality of this resolution. And I should add, even Carter used it during the hostage crisis of 1980 and then ignored it during that same hostage crisis of 1980. In other words, he used it when it suited him, and he did not use it when it did not suit him. And the what Carter did in 1980 is, in a sense, I think, precedent for what a lot of other presidents have done. They've used it occasionally, and they have not used it occasionally, and it's very, very difficult to find a clear-cut pattern in all of this. In any case, when presidents have used it, they have tended to say they are using it, that they are using force consistent with, okay, consistent with the War Powers Resolution, not pursuant to the resolution. And I don't want to get very technical here, but that little distinction has something to do with the degree to which presidents have generally argued again and again that the War Powers Resolution is unconstitutional, or at least some important provisions of the War Powers Resolution is unconstitutional. So I want to make three final points about the War Powers Resolution. Number one, there is a lot of debate over its legitimacy, over its legality, over whether it is constitutional. Top-notch legal scholars and constitutional scholars stand on both sides of this issue. It kind of makes it difficult for those of us who are non-experts in constitutional theory or constitutional law to know whether or not it's constitutional. Secondly, does the War Powers Resolution unconstitutionally limit the president's constitutional authority to serve as commander-in-chief? I want to remind you that the measure in 1973 was justified by the so-called elastic clause of the Constitution, the so-called necessary and proper clause, which is a rather spongy justification in contrast to the more specific provisions of Article Number 1 and Article Number 2. And finally, I'll end with point number 3, which is a statement made by a constitutional scholar of some reputation. His name is Barack Obama, and it was made a year before he was elected president. And what Obama said in 2007 is the following: the president does not have the power under the Constitution to unilaterally authorize a military attack in a situation that does not involve stopping an actual attack or an imminent threat to the nation. Now, by 2011, with a number of constitutional experts in the Department of Justice agreeing with him, he reversed course and claimed that, in Libya, the War Powers Resolution did not apply. And he continues to say exactly that in 2013 regarding Syria. So much for consistency.
Thank you very much. Very good. The War Powers Act that lays out, I think, some important points for discussion. Chris Churchill?
Yeah, thanks. I'll continue on with the issue of the War Powers Resolution.
Okay.
Is that okay, Chris? I'll continue on with the War Powers Resolution, and instead of focusing on the legality, talk a little bit about its effectiveness or lack of effectiveness since it's been used. So has the War Powers Act, or Resolution of 1973, acted as a restraint on the President's use of military force? The record is at best mixed. Here I'll be drawing primarily, though not exclusively, on a Congressional Research Service report from 2001. The War Powers Resolution of 1973, as Gary Ostrower helped explain, has a few key provisions, and I'm just going to quickly go over two of them again. First, that Congress must be consulted by the President when the U.S. Armed Forces enter into hostilities. Second, according to Section 4A1 of the Resolution, whenever the President introduces U.S. Armed Forces into overseas hostilities, a clock starts. After a 60-day period, they must be removed unless Congress authorizes their mission or there's a declaration of war. Now, the War Powers Resolution was already invoked just as the war in Vietnam was ending. The first and only time that Section 4A1, setting time limits, was cited by a president in consultation with Congress was under President Ford. The event was the retaking of the U.S. merchant vessel, the SS Mayaguez, which had been seized by a Cambodian naval patrol boat. Already, there was disagreement about what consultation meant. For President Ford, this meant written notification, which he provided Congress. However, for members of Congress, the impression was that consultation should mean that the President meet and discuss the action with Congress and seek their actual input. controversies centered on the need to invoke the resolution at all, or the need for the president to comply with the time limits established in Section 4A1, continued through the 1980s. This included the dispatching of U.S. military advisors to El Salvador and Honduras, over 1,000 Marines to Lebanon in 1982, as well as other actions in Grenada, Libya, and Panama. In the 1990s, the Persian Gulf War and the conflict in the former Republic of Yugoslavia increasingly blurred the certainty that Congress need be consulted at all. With the 1999 military intervention in Kosovo, by UN mandate, with NATO forces, which included U.S. troops, many of the tensions concerning the power of the War Powers Resolution came to a head. Kosovo was nominally part of Serbia, though the population was overwhelmingly and continues to be overwhelmingly ethnic Albanian. The Kosovo Liberation Army was engaged in a guerrilla war with Serbian military and paramilitary forces. Systematic terror, rape, and murder followed. In March 1999, President Clinton notified Congress, quote, consistent with the War Powers Resolution, quote, that U.S. military forces had begun airstrikes in cooperation with the NATO-led military operation in Kosovo. By May, when the 60th day had passed, Clinton argued that the War Powers Resolution was constitutionally defective. Congressional plaintiffs actually brought forth a suit alleging that President Clinton was conducting military activities in Yugoslavia without prior authorization from Congress to extend the mission. The suit was dismissed by the U.S. District Court and brought all the way up to the Supreme Court, which refused to hear the appeal. The more recent conflict in Libya, and now potentially with Syria, has not lessened the controversy about this resolution. So what does consultation with Congress really mean? Does it involve actual discussion, or just a notice of a president's decision? Is a 60-day deadline vital? What if the mission is operating under the mandate of the UN or NATO? Does this change things? Has the resolution actually acted as a check on the president's calling for overseas military conflict? We know that the resolution continues to exist. Its success is less easily proven.
Thank you. Thank you. Emrys, can you answer those questions?
No, I can't. I'm not going to try. My brief, the reason I'm on the panel is I'm a moral philosopher, so I'm going to talk about the moral aspect of this. And the occasion for this panel, of course, is the events in Syria. And the question of what the US should do in response to the use of chemical weapons in Syria. I'm going to leave aside legal, constitutional, and domestic political issues and focus on the moral. There's a whole branch of moral philosophy known as just war theory, devoted to ethical questions related to warfare. And according to this theory, the first and most basic question we have to ask is the cause just? Well, what can we say about that? Let's assume for the sake of argument that Assad was responsible for the use of chemical weapons in August. This hasn't been proved beyond doubt, but it seems likely. The stated purpose of a US strike in response is to deter Assad and any other ruler, commander, or government from using chemical weapons in the future. Given how horrible chemical weapons are, that sounds like a worthy cause, but can this justification be taken at face value? Here we have a disconnect between the way the matter is presented, received, and discussed within the US by our mainstream politicians, press, and pundits, and the way it is viewed in many other parts of the world. Let's suppose the US bombs Syria. Imagine the next day you ask people on the street in a host of other countries around the world, Russia, China, Brazil, Pakistan, Egypt, South Africa, Venezuela, India, Nigeria, but why did the US just bomb Syria? I suspect the most common answer you'd get wouldn't be, oh, they did it to deter the bad guys from using bad weapons. I think the most common answer you'd get would be something along the lines of, they did it to assert their power and protect their interests. Why this cynicism regarding the US government's motives? I think the answer is fairly simple. In many people's eyes, the US government doesn't occupy the moral high ground in international relations. Its foreign policy very often appears self-interested and cynical, so it's reasonable to suspect its motives and be cynical about its public statements. Notice we too are cynical about what others say. Russian President Vladimir Putin recently published an op-ed in the New York Times in which he talks about the importance of international law, human rights, and the equality of nations. The typical response of commentators here has been, yeah, right, as if Putin gives a damn about any of that. Why such cynicism? Well, perhaps because this is a former KGB officer who supported brutal military action in Chechnya, has political opponents arrested, beaten and jailed, and is even suspected of having some of his critics assassinated. In other words, Putin has no business pretending he occupies the moral high ground. But in the eyes of millions around the world, neither does Obama, or any other representative of the US government. Why not? Well, there's 101 reasons. Most obviously, there is a long succession of invasions, occupations or bombing campaigns in places like Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, Panama, Grenada, Afghanistan and Iraq. In recent years, US missiles, bombs and drones have killed civilians in Sudan, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Syria and Yemen. The US government has worked actively to overthrow democratically elected governments or has supported anti-democratic forces in places like Chile, Nicaragua, El Salvador, Venezuela and Honduras. In many cases, the actions of the military and intelligence services were either secret or justified by lies. They also, incidentally, turned a blind eye to Saddam Hussein's use of chemical weapons in the Iran-Iraq war. The US government has provided diplomatic, economic and military support to ruthless, oppressive dictatorships which it knows full well are guilty of imprisoning, torturing and killing civilians. Yet it maintains an unjustifiable embargo on Cuba. American troops abused and tortured prisoners in the prisons at Abu Ghraib and Guantanamo Bay. Guantanamo Bay, which is widely condemned around the world, remains operational, holding detainees who've never been tried or even charged with any crime, some of whom even the US government says should be released. The US refuses to be party to the International Criminal Court, even though it calls for Assad to be tried there as a war criminal. It shields the Israeli government's egregious policies towards the Palestinians from being censored by the UN Security Council. And thanks to Edward Snowden's whistleblowing, we've just learned that the National Security Agency has been illegally intercepting emails and phone calls to and from the presidents of Brazil and Mexico and spying on the populations of many other countries. The list goes on. You could say some of this is ancient history. I mean, the brutal coup that overthrew Allende in Chile happened almost exactly 40 years ago, but that misses the point. Many people around the world see these actions not as rare moral lapses, occasional instances where the US fails to live up to its own ideals. No, they see them as constituting a systematic pattern of the US government asserting its power, promoting American business interests, and thwarting attempts by other countries to achieve economic, political, and ideological independence. How does this relate to Syria? Simple. The US cannot seriously claim to occupy any sort of moral high ground. So when Obama asks other countries to support yet another military action, or he threatens military strikes, or carries them out, regardless of what's actually going on in his mind, people are naturally cynical. They suspect it's just more of the same old, American capitalism throwing its weight around. That is one reason why support from allies is hard to come by. It's also why any US military action is likely to be viewed skeptically, to arouse hostility, and to further inflame anti-American feelings. And all of that has to be weighed in the balance when trying to calculate the likely effects of military action. And in my view, it puts quite a lot of weight on the negative scale. So what should be done? I don't have a solution to the situation in Syria any more than anyone else does. As I've indicated, I think punitive military strikes against Assad will probably do more harm than good, although I understand the contrary view, and I don't think it's obviously foolish or wrong. I am in favour of anything that will alleviate the suffering of the Syrian refugees and help bring about a ceasefire in the civil war. Thinking longer term, though, I do have a set of suggestions for what the US government should do. They should draw a line under their lamentable past record of cynical and self-interested interventions and begin a principled ascent to the moral high ground from where they can legitimately hold the country up as a light to the nations. As a start, they should close Guantanamo, join the International Criminal Court, stop drone attacks that risk civilian lives, stop supporting coups against elected governments, stop giving or selling arms to oppressive dictatorships, or to anyone for that matter, lift the embargo on Cuba, stop the illegal wiretapping tappings of foreign governments, take the lead on environmental issues, and greatly increase the amount of aid given to the world's neediest people, especially in the areas of healthcare and education. In actual fact, the US already does a lot of good around the world through the US Agency for International Development, through the UN, through organisations like the Peace Corps, and many other non-profit organisations. Unfortunately, this good stuff often gets overshadowed by the bad. But the best way to prevent that happening in the future is for the US to live up to its own ideals. Of course, People are going to say this is rampant idealism, and they are right. Do I think this is going to happen anytime soon? No, I don't. But sketching the ideal serves a valuable purpose. It reminds us that there is an alternative to what we've been doing, and there is an alternative to yet another act of war.
Thank you. Joe, you have some thoughts here?
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Share with us briefly here.
Yeah, so again, my name is Joe Sempolinski, so I'm sort of on the panel, I guess, for two reasons. One is, as I stated, was my sort of academic background as a graduate student in political science and my teaching background in constitutional law. What I do with my day job is I'm the district director for United States Congressman Tom Reed, who is the congressman for this congressional district, an alum of this university. I think we've got a couple of his old professors up here. And so what I do day to day is I run the half of his staff that's in New York State and the other half is at the Capitol. And so I'm his eyes and ears in the district, but I'm also in many ways your advocate when we're making decisions in our staff on major issues. And I'm the one that sort of tells the congressman what his district feels and thinks. So it's very important to have these type of discussions. So I'll try and wear both hats and cover both issues. What we're dealing with the broader question of war powers is probably the most sensitive, the most life or death type of example of something that's inherent in the constitutional structure. Our Constitution is built to be a system where different power bases compete with each other, where they have overlapping authorities, where they, as James Madison said in the Federalist Papers, ambition is made to counter ambition. And it's very stark in the Constitution on the war powers issue. Dr. Ostrower mentioned at the very beginning of his talk. We have, at the same time, in Article 1, the Congress given the power to declare war. Important to note, not the power to make war. That was actually, there was a vote in the Constitutional Convention on whether to change it to that. The thought being that there will always be cases where you have to repel an invasion, that there has to be something that has to be done without congressional approval. No one ever figured out exactly what that line is going to be. But the power to declare war, very explicit in Article 1. The power of the commander-in-chief, very explicit in Article 2. This is an inherent tension, and I think the reason that we're still talking about this 200-plus years later is because of that ambiguity. There really are no easy answers to these type of questions. It's the same tension that exists throughout our constitutional processes where our legislature authorizes actions, makes laws, and the president has to execute them. Sometimes the president does things that the Congress feels is of beyond what he was authorized to do, be it in war or other areas, and sometimes the executive feels that the legislature is micromanaging. We have those going on throughout our entire structure. So this is a very stark example of this. It's an example that goes beyond just the everyday. It goes into real life or death situations. There's two ways in which this this tension plays out. One is, as I said, a difference between authorization and execution. The legislature determines whether someone is able to go to military activity. The president may feel that they don't have that power. Most of the time, that's the process that goes through, and I think I'm going to get to in a minute why I think that actually happens. But there's another tension that exists both in war and with our other areas, is the power of the purse, power of money. He who has the gold makes the rules. And the president is in many ways hamstrung by the power that he does not control appropriations. When the Congress feels that a previously enacted law, a previously authorized military conflict is not appropriate any longer, but does not have the wherewithal or ability to break through the gridlock, oftentimes they try to defund something. This was attempted in Vietnam. There's been talk about it in later conflicts. This particular tension of the president has to execute the laws he was told to execute, but he doesn't have the means to do it unless the Congress continues to providing those dollars. These tensions remain. They exist. They are perpetual. They wax and wane between the legislature and the presidency as to who is on top, who is not. In the Nixon era, there was an attempt to sort of codify it, to clean it up, as was described, the War Powers Resolution. No president feels that's constitutional. And it, I think one very pertinent example, as Dr. Ostrower said, is the current president. You know, where you stand on constitutional issues is quite often determined by where you sit. So when you're a senator and you're in the legislature, you may feel that the Congress is the one that should be calling the shots. A few years later, when you're in a different seat, you're the president, lo and behold, your position's changed. So the War Powers Resolution was something that was passed at a moment when the pendulum had swung very far in favor of the legislature due to the actions of the executive in Vietnam. Subsequent years, that pendulum has swung back to the executive. It swung back to the legislature in response to Iraq. So these things, I would most importantly, from a constitutional perspective, say, don't happen in a vacuum. You might ask, why hasn't the Supreme Court weighed in and said once and for all, you know, why, what one thing is legal, one thing's not? But each of these situations that develops is individual, it's based on contingency, and there's one factor I think very few people bring into constitutional thought, but is very important to understanding what actually happens, and that's public opinion and the political realities of the moment. When something is popular, the president's going to be able to get away pretty much with whatever he wants to do. When something is unpopular, we start having these disputes and arguments. Supreme Court is very hesitant to weigh in because of these wild popularity swings, because they don't have the money or the army to back up their assertion of authority like the Congress and the president do. So what ends up being the deciding factor in many cases, and this is probably a good thing given a Democratic republic, is the people. And so my personal experience, I've been with in three cases where authorization was thought about in the room with members of Congress who are making these decisions. About 10 years ago, and this was sort of by dumb luck, Congressman Houghton was the congressman for this district. And I was an intern. I was a kid that, you know, fetched the faxes and the mail and everything. And we had a meeting where the congressman brought every one of his staff, paid and unpaid, into the room. And we went through and said, should we vote to authorize use of force in Iraq? And, you know, the staff was about 50-50. But one of the biggest considerations that the congressman had was, well, where are the constituents on this? In that case, it didn't help too much. The constituents were about 50-50 as well. But that was the type of decision-making that went on. At least in Mr. Houghton's mind, he may have been an exception to the rule for a variety of reasons. The president's political pressure was much less of a consideration in the room when he was making those decisions than the political pressure that came from the actual people to vote for. The other two examples are in my time as a staffer for Mr. Reed, Libya and Syria. And I think they're intrinsically related because I don't think you can understand what happened with Syria without understanding what happened with Libya from a congressional context. Congressman Reed found out that we intervened with Libya on CNN. He doesn't, and I don't, feel that's constitutionally appropriate. A member of Congress should not know that we're engaging in a military strike of that type of scale without some sort of notification. Now, the president did get around to notifying Congress 2 days later when it had already been started. He argued that there was a UN resolution, that there was NATO allies in place that said this was acceptable. Subsequently, several months later, far longer than the president said was actually going to be the amount of time we were in Libya, we did have two votes in Congress on what to do. One of them was a vote to authorize an additional year of use of force for Libya. It was sponsored by some of the president's Democratic allies. That vote failed. Congressman Reed was one of the folks who voted against it. He did not feel it was appropriate that we were in Libya, but we did have the vote. Second, there was a vote on whether to defund the Libya campaign. Surprisingly, that vote also failed. So the Congress sent a very mixed message to the president on what was a action that was viewed in a mixed realm by the public. And we said, you can't do this, but we're not going to take your money away to do it, which doesn't really stop the president. But there was a lot of pent-up frustration with the fact that he had done this without any congressional authority. So Syria happened, and the president had drawn his red line, and Assad apparently had crossed it. And the way we handled it in our office was, this was over Labor Day weekend, and we had a conference call with all our senior staff very early on the Sunday of Labor Day weekend. And we decided we have to, you know, figure out what we're going to do. We just found out the night before that we're probably going to vote. And we all went around the horn and we said our thoughts, and about, you know, two-thirds of our staff were one way, a third were the other. And the congressman said, well, what we have to do is we have to go talk to the people. And we very hastily put together six town hall meetings. The nearest one was in Hornell. And we went out and talked to folks. And by the time those 2 days had finished, the president, the Speaker of the House, the majority leader, Republicans and Democrats and leadership had come out in favor of going to Syria. However, about 95% of the folks that contacted our office were against it. That was sort of where the majority of our staff was. That's where Tom's head was. But it was a situation where the first thought on the member of Congress's mind was, what's public opinion? And this was the reaction I would guess most members of Congress, Republican and Democrat, were getting from their constituency. And so it became very politically problematic for the president to go into Syria. He had, in his view, and in the view of Secretary Kerry, the power to do it. He still has the power to do it. He can do it anytime he wants. But there was, when he was considering doing it, there was a public outcry that was embodied in a letter from well over 100 members of Congress to the president, including my boss signing it, saying, you can't do this. You have to come to Congress. This is our interpretation of the Constitution. I think if this had been a wildly popular engagement, you wouldn't have seen that letter, and you wouldn't have seen the president coming to Congress. But due to the political pressure that had been put on to him, he came to Congress, and we were prepared to vote it down. Now, subsequent to that, a diplomatic solution is presented itself, and we may not actually have to go, but the president maintains his authority to do that. So the takeaway I would have from my experience, both constitutional and practical, is the wording of the Constitution has, and in my view, intentionally presented an ambiguity on whether in any given particular situation the president or the Congress is the first mover, the first actor. There are extreme examples when we're mobilizing for a full war that clearly it's something where the Congress should be declaring war. And at the other extreme, you know, perhaps a response to an invasion or something like that, where the president has clear authority. But in probably 99% of cases, it's ambiguous. And while, you know, we can sit here and debate, you know, what perhaps is the intention of the founders and what perhaps is that line between the two, at the end of the day, where the rubber really hits the road, And I think this is a very good thing, and part of the wisdom of the way the Constitution's constructed, the one that's going to make the decision isn't really a member of Congress or the president or anybody in position of power. It's going to be the people they answer to. It's going to be the public. And you will see that members of Congress, the presidency, go to the public, try to persuade the public to their personal point of view, but I would not want anybody to walk out this room thinking that they don't have the power to sway whether we go to war or not, because they do.
Thank you. Jeff, you got some closing thoughts here?
There's kind of a gap between the three presenters furthest to my right, talking about war powers in the Constitution, and Emrys and I, who focus more on questions of the decision to intervene in Syria to respond to the use of chemical weapons. Emrys said about three-quarters of what I've been planning to say much more eloquently than I had been planning to say it. And so he didn't even leave me chili. I'm a Latin Americanist. It's really no fair for him to take my best example. But I'm very concerned. As someone who has lived a fair amount of my life abroad, I consider myself an American citizen, but also a global citizen, and I'm concerned about how the United States is viewed in its interventions abroad. I think that a part of our power in the world today, a big part of our power, is what we call soft power, our ability to attract, persuade, to inspire peoples around the world. And that it's not just military power that's, in the end of the day, is going to necessarily take us where we want to go. So there's this, in our U.S. foreign policy decisions, we're a very moralistic country when it comes to declaring the reasons, the justifications for our interventions abroad. And we always have, you know, we're doing it to liberate this people, to bring democracy to this country, to save the women of Afghanistan, to this, to do this and that. And that's fine, but when critical observers and realist international relations theorists and others look carefully, they see that, you know, there are underlying motivations that are not quite as attractive. And it basically comes down to our national self-interest. I mean, it's not as if the U.S. is different from any other major power in modern history. They've always ultimately pursued their national interests. But the thing about us is that we really consistently make these huge claims based in principle. We don't say we're doing it for us. We're doing it for everyone. And I think this is what often it comes to be a big problem with people in other places seeing us as being not only arrogant, but also hypocritical. And I wish, along the lines that Emrys was saying, he'd love to see us act consistently in accordance with our principles and have our principles really drive our policies. But I, too, don't see any real likelihood of that happening in the near future. But just to give you an example, I mean, Emrys had this incredible laundry list of examples. And I thought I'd just mention a couple of them. One from Latin America, more historical, is that many of you will remember the Iran-Contra scandal. And I mean, the U.S. supported an armed force made up of largely members of the Nicaraguan dictator Somoza's National Guard, which had been really treating the population of Nicaragua rather roughly for years. They'd risen up against him and overthrown Somoza. But the people who defeated Somoza were political forces on the left. They were self-described. Many of them were Marxist-Leninists, and they allied more closely with the Soviet Union than with Western countries, though they did have fairly good relations with a number, especially West European countries. But anyway, the U.S., when Ronald Reagan came to power in 1980, about a year after the Sandinistas overthrew Somoza in Nicaragua, they created an army in southern Honduras and another force eventually in northern Costa Rica to launch attacks on the country. And these forces used really despicable methods. I mean, they attacked and killed innocent civilians in villages throughout northern Nicaragua. They were trying to basically, I mean, it was seen widely as a kind of a terrorist strategy to undermine support for the Sandinistas. And they were denounced for crimes. And there was Congress learning of the you know, very clear evidence of really atrocious behavior on the part of the Contras, cut off funding, voted in the Boland Amendment in 1982 to cut off funding. But then the U.S. government went around that and got outside funding from places like Iran, which, you know, it's an example of U.S. policy that we say we're doing it to stop communism, to liberate the people of Nicaragua, and so forth and so on, but our actions, when you look at them carefully, don't always match our stated principles. And more recently, I mean, and more relevant to the example of Syria, is, of course, something Emrys mentioned, and that was that in 1979, the Iranian Revolution produced Ayatollah Khomeini and an Islamic state that was very anti-U.S. And so when its neighbor, Iraq, led by Saddam Hussein, and with concerns that its own population might side with the Iranian Revolution due to ethnic and religious similarities, a huge part of the Iraq population is Shiite, as the population, most of the population of Iran. So the U.S. When Hussein, Saddam Hussein, leader of Iraq, attacked Iran and started the Iraq-Iran war, the U.S. tended to side with Saddam Hussein. Now, what we knew, the thing I want to emphasize about that is that Saddam Hussein, we know it's been written about recently, especially in Foreign Policy magazine, we knew, the CIA knew that Saddam Hussein was using chemical weapons. In part because they served very well to counter the Iranians' tactics of mass waves of poorly armed soldiers just running across the battlefield. So chemical weapons were very effective in that situation. But the U.S. knew about it. We didn't denounce it at the U.N. We didn't do much of anything about it. Later in the war, when it looked like Saddam Hussein was going to possibly lose the war, Iran, there was a moment in 1986-87 when Iran was planning an offensive. It looked like the Iranian forces might break through and take a major city in southern Iraq. The U.S. actively supported Hussein, providing information and so forth, knowing that he would use chemical weapons, which he did in several major battles, killing thousands of people. So this example of, well, when Saddam Hussein was our ally, we looked the other way. We looked the other way when he used chemical weapons. Now Assad is our enemy. We want him out. And so now he's a terrible criminal that has to be stopped. So it's that kind of thing, those kinds of examples, that I think, you know, it would be nice to think that we could do better in avoiding them and acting in accordance with our principles.
Thank you. Well, we certainly have a range of thoughts and opinions here. If the panel has any quite further comments or questions of each other, we can take a. But I want the answers limited to 1 or 2 minutes. Any thoughts here? Anybody want to attack anybody or praise anybody? Further thoughts?
Yeah, I'll use a chemical weapons attack against Jeff Sluyter-Beltrao here.
That would be new.
Okay, get to it, Jerry.
A couple things. I think that I'm a diplomatic historian, okay? So, you know, my specialty is something, you know, knowing something presumably about foreign policy and the way in which nations at least historically have acted. I have no quarrel with anything that Emrys had said in respect to the bad behavior of the U.S. And perhaps, you know, I come into all of this with not quite as you know, cynical as Emrys in light of all of this, because I have low expectations. You know, it's kind of like the way I approach my golf game. The reason I enjoy golf is because of my low expectations, and I think that I can even enjoy, not enjoy, but appreciate a good deal about American diplomacy because I don't have such high expectations. Having said that, the fact of the matter is that we're watching right now, I think, the end of you know, what political scientists might describe as the chemical weapons, the anti-chemical weapons regime. In other words, a whole series of measures going all the way back to the Hague Conventions of 1899 and then 1906, and then, of course, the Geneva Conventions of 1925 and 1949, and a bunch of other things as well, leading to the chemical weapons treaty in 1992, I guess it is. I think we're seeing that collapse. In other words, if, you know, if Syria gets away with using it, others may use it. Now, maybe I'm wrong about that. And of course, the diplomatic efforts on the part of the Russians and maybe the Americans to eliminate Syrian chemical weapons may turn out to be just fine. And perhaps I'm worried about something that I shouldn't be. But I do think that, you know, we tend to be. Because of Iraq, because of our disillusionment, because we're tired of war, not only in Iraq but in Afghanistan, I think we tend to be, you know, somewhat more perhaps isolationist on this kind of an issue than we should be. I'm very fearful that, you know, we're going to see the return of chemical weapons in a very, very ugly way in future wars. The one other point that I would make, and this in a way perhaps more response to something that Mr. Sempolinski said, which is that the public really does have a lot of influence. I agree that the public does, but I question as to how much influence the public should have. I want to offer you at least one historical footnote here. And that is that in just before World War II, 1940-1941, a congressman from North Dakota by the name of Ludlow had offered an amendment fearing that the United States would indeed, you know, with FDR, involve itself in World War II. This man was an isolationist. And so he proposed an amendment to the Constitution that came very, very close to being adopted by the House of Representatives. In the final analysis, it was not, at least in part also, because of a good deal of, you know, politicking by FDR. It was called the Ludlow Amendment, and it would have subjected to a popular vote an American decision to go to war. Okay? It failed, so we don't talk about the Ludlow Amendment. But that, in a way, is the kind of the end point, perhaps the logical extension of this argument that the public should have its say before we commit troops throughout at war.
I guess you don't have a question, then.
I guess that's right.
I have a question.
Hold it. Eris has a question.
Well, I have a point and a question. My point is that I can vouch for the fact that Gary's low expectations regarding his golf game are thoroughly justified. <Yes. laughs> My question is to Joe. Mm-hmm. Joe, I found your account of the deliberations very, very interesting. Mm-hmm. And I wondered if, in your experience, there'd ever been any deliberations that referred to international law.
I would say, at least in my experience, it's been tangential in the sense that in the two cases where we had some serious deliberations, Iraq and Syria, there was some concern about violation of maybe international norms in the sense that in Iraq that we were enforcing UN resolutions that had come out of the Iraq invasion of Kuwait, and that Hussein had been a flagrant, you know, violator of these going back to his incidents with Iran, and this was beyond the pale or beyond norms. In Syria, there was a discussion of, you know, the red line. You know, was the president now says, well, it's not my red line, it's the world's red line. Was, you know, he's sort of jumping back and forth on that. But the consideration was, as was sort of stated by Dr. Ostrower, if we don't do anything, what does that mean for the further use of chemical weapons as an international norm? Is this an accepted practice? And because it was sort of interesting that, you know, the Assad regime in this conflict has killed 100,000 people through conventional means, but now we, you know, 1,000 people through this other means, it's suddenly very different. Is that norm something that, in and of itself, is something that needs to be upheld? But I would say that the primary consideration is, and I think this is constitutionally important, was the views of the constituency. And I think you may have a different consideration if you were talking to somebody that was at a Senate staffer deliberation. They obviously have longer terms of office. They handle more foreign affairs for those very reasons, that they're a little isolated from the day-to-day feelings of the constituencies. But as far as the deliberations that I was in the room for with Mr. Houghton and Mr. Reed, the primary consideration was the views of our constituents, and is this decision beyond the views of the moment in the long-term interest of those same constituents? And obviously sometimes that short-term feeling and long-term interest can be intention, but that it was much more of a what's in the best interest of the United States, and then we did have a talk of international norms.
Okay. I'll turn this over to the audience. You fellas ready? Do we have any questions here for any thoughts there? Yeah, Autumn?
So I found this discussion extremely interesting. I come at it from more of the international relations angle, so I wanted to hit on that just a bit, because one of the things, there's this tension, I think, between the realpolitik and the morality arguments, and that came out very clearly in what you two talked about, and in some ways what the others talked about as well. But one thing that was not mentioned was R2P, or the responsibility to protect. And this is what was invoked in Libya. This is what passed the UN Security Council, and this is what ultimately authorized NATO to go into Libya. This is what was sought for Syria, but UK friends and US could not get. And the question that I would pose is, can we not get it for reasons of morality or reasons of realpolitik? Because we know that Russia is very closely aligned with Al-Assad, and so there's the realpolitik tension here. And then we also see that perhaps, you know, this idea of selective intervention, or the reality of selective intervention, which the U.S. and other countries often engage in, France.
Yeah, so you're asking R2P, where we have a responsibility to follow up on that?
Well, I'm asking about this tension between which is guiding the policies here, and
So the question is...
Right, is it the fear to engage in responsibility to protect, or to invoke responsibility to protect, I should say, because of Libya, or is it because of more realpolitik that we're not entering into Syria?
I wonder if I could just twist that a little bit and ask Emrys if there is such a thing as R2P. Would that be a basis for war?
I think that, as I understand, under the current United Nations Charter, that isn't one of the reasons that you can justify an act of war.
No,
I would like...
The question is, is there a moral responsibility? I'd
be happy to say, yes, sometimes there is a moral responsibility. In the case of Libya, I thought there was actually a pretty good reason to try and prevent Gaddafi from massacring a civilian population. And so I actually think that it would be a very good thing if the United Nations could modify its charter to incorporate as a legitimate kind of action a responsibility to protect. But achieving that is very difficult for real politic reasons.
Is there a philosophical position anywhere that supports the R2P? You want to call on anybody besides yourself?
I wanted to follow up on that, not on the question of moral philosophy. But this R2P, I think R2P could have really been consolidated more strongly as a principle when the imperiled population of Benghazi was being served. But part of the problem, of course, is that the U.S., U.K., and France went beyond the decision of the United Nations, which was to protect the people, and went on to go ahead and go after Gaddafi. And so, coming out of that, Russia and China and many countries around the world, we're not going to give them another pass. We can't afford to do that because the U.S., and they just went beyond the mandate. So, unfortunately, I think that would have been a case in which it could have been actually strengthened, but it was an opportunity that was lost.
Yeah. Anybody on the end there?
And I would just very quickly follow up by problematizing the distinction between R2P as a moral guideline and then maybe realpolitik decisions. I think that those decisions can use R2P as justification, right? And I think the fact that's, if anything, the likelier outcome of using that kind of language.
Another question?
Should we be the moral police of the world?
Well, who else would be?
As a Canadian, I have a suggestion.
You're talking about the country here. We've got to see what he wants to do. Chris.
No, I think that is a really, really good question. I think that there's a place for intervention from many countries, and I don't think this is only a responsibility the United States should bear. But I think that that responsibility has to be also grounded in an understanding not just of American constitutional law, which I think was really well discussed here, as well as moral issues, but also understanding the specific historical circumstances of those countries in which intervention is going to happen. I'll give you a very specific example of Syria. How many people here are aware that the U.S. has already engaged in two coup d'etat attempts against Syrian governments? Couple of people. Now, if I asked that in Syria, there'd be quite a few more hands, I'm going to assume, that would rise here. So the first coup d'etat post-World War II in the Middle East was in Syria with U.S. authorization and CIA support. The first democratically elected president of Syria was overthrown, Shukri al-Kuwaiti. 1957. There was another coup d'etat attempt, much more poorly organized, that was found out. One of the agents was arrested and eventually released to the Americans. Now, so there's that issue. One of the other countries that is most for intervention in Syria right now is France. Now, one of the means of intervening in Syria that's been proposed is aerial bombardment, right, of select targets. Well, what has France historically done in Syria? It has repeatedly bombed Syrian civilian targets during the French occupation of Syria, including in the month of May 1945, which was, some folks probably here know, the year in which Germany was finally defeated in World War II. That same month, France was bombarding Damascus. So I think that doesn't invalidate the United States and France intervening in Syria. But it certainly means that there has to be more awareness of what it looks like from a Syrian perspective when that intervention is most forcefully argued by the U.S. and France, how the particular histories of Syria are ones that's going to be refocused in a way that's going to produce a lot more skepticism, right? And so I think knowing those histories of previous interventions by France and the U.S., I think that would go a long way towards, I think, a better discussion of whether the U.S. should intervene in certain cases, and if they do, how it should go about intervening, right? Being sensitive to those histories that I think most Americans, for very obvious reasons, 1940s and 1950s, might be unaware of, but certainly in the case of Syrians, are much more aware of this past.
Any other thoughts on that?
I'll offer a thought.
Well, sure.
I don't think the U.S. should be the moral police of the world. I think the United Nations should be. And I think the U.S. foreign policy should be to do everything to improve the standing and the status of the United Nations to fulfill that task. It's very difficult, partly because of the structure of the United Nations, with the five permanent members of the Security Council having a veto. But of course, those five members, they want to hold on to that veto. I actually think the U.S. should propose a change in the structure of the United Nations where the permanent members give up their veto. And again, this is rampant idealism, I know.
I'm glad you're speaking that way about it, because I hear this arrogance by a lot of people that I know high in the military that we're the only one who knows what the hell's going on in the world, and I resent it.
Okay, so I have a question for Emrys with a slight hypothetical. The year is 1994. Rwandans are killing Rwandans, okay? Hutus are killing Tutsis in large numbers. And the only way that's going to be prevented is if there is military intervention from the outside. And it's brought to the United Nations. As a matter of fact, the UN had withdrawn its troops, led by, I might add, a Canadian. And and we can assume that one of those five countries is going to veto UN intervention in Rwanda. Should the United States intervene as Madeleine Albright in retrospect had said it should have done, and as Clinton, as a matter of fact, had said in retrospect that it should have done?
My answer is, in retrospect, I could say sure, because the loss of life was horrendous. But what the United States should have done is, in the years preceding that, done everything it could to
change the atmosphere of international politics in the direction of people taking more principled, less self-interested positions, both at the United Nations and everywhere else.
Yeah, I'd follow up. In 1994 is a good year, but we could go a little bit earlier, like with Emrys, but I'll be maybe more specific here. There's certainly evidence that France was to some degree complicit in the heightening of the tensions, indeed arguably the genocide itself that took place in Rwanda. So the question, does the United States intervene? When and where should it be intervening, and against whom? I think that's a more important question here. Like, the obvious answer is, well, troops need to be in Rwanda. But merely preventing France from its sort of great game politics in Central Africa would have also completely changed the dynamic, and certainly the vitriol in Rwanda at the time. I think it's a little problematic to just imagine that these are problems that arise in a particular country like Rwanda, that there isn't already intervention already at play, right? In this case, France. And so when we talk about U.S. intervention, it doesn't necessarily have to involve military intervention somewhere, but merely maybe disrupting intervention by other forces like France in that case.
Any other thoughts there? Any questions?
I was intrigued with the poll from the public that you were talking about in regards to whether or not to take engagement. Yes, very frank. My question is what kind of poll does the public have when you're already engaged?
Okay, the constitutional point broadly I'll make, and then I'll try and get into some of the specifics. We have, as I said, these tensions between the branches of government, many of which the Supreme Court refuses to adjudicate for reasons of self-preservation and, in some cases, reasons that they feel it's constitutionally inappropriate. What ends up happening is... I'm sorry. Thank you. So the final arbiter ends up being public opinion, both through expressed public opinion and then ultimately through elections. So at the end of the day, if the public overwhelmingly turns against an intervention, those folks that are supporting it are probably going to be voted out of office. And that fear of loss of employment is something that can actually change people's minds down in the Capitol. In the case of the particular example of Syria in this district, it was something that was of high concern. Like I said, the process we went through was we sort of talked about it amongst ourselves. Tom came to his own personal conclusions, and then we went out and talked to the folks to see if they had a different perspective. What was interesting was that in this case with Syria, you had folks that were against it for very different reasons, but came to the same conclusion. You had people that perhaps were more pacifist, that didn't believe in intervention, maybe period, against it. You had folks that are isolationists, that felt that it was not an appropriate circumstance for the Americans intervening because it had not affected them directly. And most interestingly, we had folks who were, perhaps more likely to intervene, perhaps folks that may have been in favor of Afghanistan and Iraq, but felt that what was being proposed would be ineffectual. That, yes, it's bad that chemical weapons were used, but a pinpoint, unbelievably small, I believe it was the Secretary of State's word, strike, wouldn't work. So what you see in our district, I think, was a microcosm. What you see across the country is folks became very hesitant. In our case, it was leading us where the congressman's head already was, but folks became very hesitant to cross that much of a public opinion. Stops it from happening in the first place. What you end up having in, perhaps, the example Vietnam is, we have a repeal of the Tonkin Gulf resolution, as was stated. Ultimately, funds get cut off, and Saigon falls. We've pulled out. Ford goes to Congress and says, we need to save our South Vietnamese allies, and the Congress says, no way. We've had enough. So the world does not turn on a dime, neither does public opinion, and neither does the U.S. government. But over the medium to long term, it becomes very difficult to sustain intervention in the face of public opinion. And I think that what, as I said, what you see in Syria is in the context of Libya for the members of Congress, but I think it's for the public in the context of Iraq and Afghanistan, where they've become very war-weary. They are asking, did we accomplish the goals that we went in to achieve, and are now asking sort of some harder questions of their leaders, you know, what's going to be the end game, you know, who are we intervening on behalf of, are the rebels really our friends? And so the public opinion reaction is not in just the context of any one intervention, it's in the context of what people have experienced over the course of their entire lifetime. So I would say, in the short answer to your question, yes, but not immediately. It takes time to build that consensus public opinion and then have it translate and trickle up to decision makers.
Okay, one more question here.
What
do you think
the public opinion? I got somebody out here. Yeah, I was wondering, so you mentioned some mental amendments that put forth by an isolationist. I was wondering if there are examples in which public opinion and or congressional opinion have been in favor of intervention at a time when the president has not been.
Could you repeat the question, because I didn't hear it?
Are there historical examples of a time when congressional opinion and or public opinion have been in favor of international intervention when the president has been against it?
Thank you.
Oh, the dog, it didn't bark.
Yeah, Mark, do there are historians there?
That's right, the dog that didn't bark. When the president did not, generally, boy, I'm going to have to think about that one for a second. I can't give you an offhand answer. I will say this, however, you know, and I'm thinking, for instance, back during the Vietnam War, there were, by this time, we had public opinion that we could measure public opinion. We had plenty of polling and so forth. There was a continual process from 1961 until 1968 or so, a continual process of escalation of that war. Before almost every one of those American escalations, okay, all of those steps, public opinion was opposed to further escalation, and the presidents, you know, pushed the envelope, that is to say, they favored it. That was true to a certain extent under Kennedy, and it was, you know, much, much truer under Johnson. You were kind of asking in the opposite direction. And I'm not, I don't know the answer to that, okay? I'll probably think about it tonight, and I'll say, gee, I should have said, but I'm really not sure right now, so I'm going to, I guess I'll just hold my tongue.
I think you've stumped the experts. Nice job.
Emrys is saying, does the Civil War serve? In what sense? In other words, with that,
what was the population in the North as enthused?
No, the population was not enthused about fighting until, in fact, that is why Lincoln maneuvered the South to fire the first shot into the Fort Sumter expedition. And I think that Lincoln knew that he would not have a divided, that he would not have a united country. Once it became clear that the South had fired on Fort Sumter, a Union fort, it was much easier for Lincoln, therefore, to call up 75,000 volunteers and then another 100,000 volunteers and so forth.
Okay, you got one comment, Joe?
Well, as an example of that scenario, I think it would also be World War II. We were talking about, you know, prior to Pearl Harbor. Roosevelt wants to intervene on behalf of Britain. He's lending him ships. He's, you know, helping out behind the scenes. But public opinion obviously massively swings against isolationism and subsequent to the Pearl Harbor attack.
Yeah, I must say, though, you have not answered the young lady's question, which was the opposite. But that's quite all right. Quite all right. Well, I want to thank you folks for attending. And I want to definitely thank the panelists. I thought everybody did a fine job.
Yeah.
And so.